Recording.
Hey everyone, just breaking in here really quickly before we get the show started. Last week when we recorded the show, the news about the Supreme Court decision hadn't been solidified. We knew about the Supreme Court decision because of the leak, but it had not actually been solidified until I think the day after we recorded last week. So we don't really talk about it on this episode. That's number one. But number two, and more importantly, this upcoming Friday the 1st of July, we are organizing with a bunch of other podcasts to create a fundraiser for abortion medication and for abortion access. It's going to be happening this upcoming Friday night, starting at 7 p.m. Central. We're looking to have on the Scathing guys. We're looking to have on Opening Arguments. We're looking to have on Knowledge Fight, hopefully a couple of other guests. Come hang out with us on the live stream. You'll be able to find it through our social media, on our YouTube page, on our Twitch, on our Facebook. You'll be able to hang out, chat with other people who are really interested in this particular topic, and be able to give money so we can raise a good sum of money to help people out, especially with this ruling coming down. We really want to make sure that we get enough money out there so that people who need help can get help. So join us this upcoming week, July 1st at 7 p.m. Central on all the Cognitive Dissonance feeds, and you'll be able to find us and hang out and donate some cash. We hope to see you there. Now, the rest of the show.
Live from Glory Hole Studios in Chicago and beyond, this is Cognitive Dissonance. Every episode, we blast anyone who gets in our way. We bring critical thinking, skepticism, and irreverence to any topic that makes the news, makes it big, or makes us mad. It's skeptical, it's political, and there is no welcome mat. This is episode 635. 635, man.
635, we're getting close, man.
We are 31 weeks away. That's got to be like an atheist golden birthday.
It really is. It's like, yeah, it's like you. It's like steak and blowjob day for us.
It is. That's exactly. It's atheist steak and blowjob
day. Atheist steak and blowjob day when you hit your 666 episode.
That's it.
A dark angel gets his wings. Oh, it'll be exciting. We got some plans. We're thinking about some stuff, but yeah.
We are definitely going to sell it. I mean, how do you not celebrate 666? And I don't know if this is the case, Cecil, but I think that we might be amongst our peers that are in the 600.
Sure, yeah.
Are we going to be the first ones hitting 666?
So a couple people will be ahead of us.
Motherfuckers.
But like Gio will be ahead of us because he's already in the sevens.
But he started recording as an infant.
Yeah, I know. He was born in utero.
Right? Wasn't he born with
Hello?
A fucking
what do you have
xylophone
say?
And a microphone? And
I love it.
I'm of course, you know, the big podcasts have been around forever. Yes. But we did a sneaky thing for a while where we were recording two episodes a week.
Yeah, we did that for like
did this for a while,
like 6 months or
yeah,
something.
Sneaky. Oh, it was like a couple of years, I think.
Wait, we did it. We did it for a while. How do I not remember recording twice a week for years?
Twice a week for a while, and then we were just like, "This is so hard. I give up." So,
oh yeah. Man, I don't even remember doing that for years.
We've been doing
this for so long.
It was a long time, but we did it. We did it for a while, and then we were just like, "That's just too much. We can't do it." And then now we just record all that in one day.
We do. It's true. It's the same volume, actually.
It's the same volume.
It's literally the same volume. It's just like
essentially doing two shows a week. We just release.
Yeah.
And we still release one on Thursday. It's the live stream. So we still technically do it. We just don't.
We're constantly producing content. Yeah. It's just that you and I are both the same way. It's like, are you a jump in the pool guy? Or are you like tiptoes in?
Yeah.
I'm a fucking jump. Like, is there
cannon
if there's a
ball? Baby.
Yeah, right.
Cannonball.
I'm ripping off band-aids left and right.
Hell
I'm
yes.
jumping in the fucking pool.
Hell yes.
Like,
absolutely.
I don't have time for that shit.
Absolutely. I'm right with you.
Who made that man a gunner?
I did, sir. He's my cousin.
Who is he?
He's an asshole, sir.
I know that. What's his name?
That is his name, sir. Asshole. Major asshole.
And his cousin?
He's an asshole too, sir. Gunner's mate, first class, Philip Asshole.
How many assholes we got on this ship anyhow?
Yo!
I knew it. I'm surrounded by assholes.
Keep firing, assholes!
So you want to talk about this article from Slate. Prove to the world you've lost your son. How a Tulsa grandmother became a vicious Sandy Hook conspiracy theorist in her own words. So this is a long form Slate piece. It's a really interesting article. You know, and I guess there's a couple of different ways to read this article. So I was thinking about this article actually on the drive over here. So the first way to read the article is, man, this is a long article about a crazy person.
Yeah.
And that's a legitimate reading of this article, right? Because if you look at it in this sort of one person view, it is a long article about one crazy person.
Yeah, right.
And like the world has always had crazy people. But I think the part that I seize on when I think and mull this over, that I think makes this different, the thing, the part of it that changes for me, is that this lady has been crazy since 1990. She's been off her fucking nut, yeah, doing conspiracy shit and calling people in the middle of the night, yeah, and fucking doing her
fighting
bullshit.
School boards. Right. And, yeah.
And up until a certain point, all of that shit, in the words of this article, and it's good, moldered in her attic, yeah, right? So at some point, she's trying to get the attention of all the powers that be, and they just hang up the phone on her.
I don't care.
And she gets no traction, and she doesn't matter. And all of her, like, bullshit, quote-unquote, research, which I also want to talk about, just, like, it just amounts to nothing. It's sound and fury signifying nothing.
Sure.
And then what changes is now she's able to connect with other people that she was not able to connect with, yeah, before, to build a sort of like network, mm-hmm, of fucking crazy people. And those assholes band together to create not just a single lady harassing people, but harassment campaigns,
yeah,
and harassment teams and harassment like protocol and harassment best practices and harassment activism.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And that's what's different about it.
Yeah.
That's the part that struck me.
You're right. She would have just been left alone 20 years ago. And they, like you say, the article pretty much says that.
Yeah.
20 years ago, she was a lady who went to her school board and basically was like, no, you shouldn't be teaching the kids this way.
Right.
And for her, for the lady, and they did, I think they did a good job of trying to explain sort of her motivations, both, mm-hmm, through her and through talking to her daughter. And the motivations are, you know what? I really feel like it's important for me to be a knowledgeable person.
Yes.
That's what she wanted out of life. Mm-hmm. I want to be a knowledgeable person.
She says it.
Yeah. Exactly.
There's this moment of self-realization.
Yeah. Yeah, where she kind of says that. And the thing is like, she just didn't know how to go about it.
Mm-hmm.
So what she did was she seized on things that were very easy, that like easy answers to things that allow you to look knowledgeable, right? It's that conspiracy thing, right?
Right.
It allows me to look like I'm the one who's peeling. I'm the detective. I'm peeling back the onion layers. I'm Jack Nicholson in that movie about incest or whatever, where he's like looking through the,
right,
the bullshit, uh-huh, card catalog in a basement somewhere. And he finally figures out that, you know, so-and-so is the daughter and then also the wife or whatever. I don't even know the name of the movie. I can't even remember the name of the movie. But you know what I'm talking about.
I do.
Right?
I know what
you're
talking
like
about.
It's like a mundane, yep, sort of thing with a big reveal. And that's what conspiracies are, right?
Yes.
This is just sort of like bullshit. And then somebody gives you this big reveal. And it's the thing is, she has no idea how to go about it. And one of the reasons why I wanted to talk about this story too is because of the internet. And she sees on Anderson Cooper, she goes and watches Anderson, yeah, Cooper at a house where she's at. And Anderson Cooper talks about a guy who's some fucking jamoke who runs a website called like memoryhole.com or something. And what happens is she stops watching Anderson Cooper and goes to Memory Hole and, yep, immediately becomes a convert. Now, there's not saying that she wasn't someone who was already primed to believe the things.
I think that's
there,
certainly
right?
true. Yep.
I think,
yep,
that that's the case. But she would have had no fucking idea and no outlet if Anderson Cooper hadn't given that a little signal boost.
Yep. Well, we're exposed to so much more now,
yeah,
than, and so I think your point is well taken. If it's 1990 and you are a person who is primed to believe in bullshit, you still only can believe in the bullshit that you, yeah, encounter.
Right.
If it's 2022 and you're primed to believe in bullshit, there is a nearly limitless amount of ways to encounter different kinds of bullshit, because our amplification technology, yes, has gotten so much better.
Yes.
I think too that you were talking and it made me write down a note that I think that there's a correlation between a kind of, and I don't mean this in a pejorative sense, but a kind of intellectual insecurity that makes us more vulnerable to conspiracy theories.
I think you're right. And it's, you know what it stems from? You know, I grew up with this sort of either you're street smart.
Yes.
Or you're book smart.
Yeah.
That right? Like there's false that whole dichotomy, idea, right? There, it's like either you're street smart or you're book smart. You can't be both. You got to be like either you're wise in the ways of the world or your nose is in a book and you know the fucking how to diagram a molecule. Those are your two options. Either you know how to get a mortgage or you know how to diagram a molecule.
Hey, you can balance your checkbook book and you balance a tire. Exactly, you know what I mean?
Exactly. So there's this idea of like that I grew up with. Yeah, and I know you were talking
about
that.
Yeah, right.
But I think at a very young age, you and I, you know, we've known each other for many years. So we were young at one point together.
We were young at one point together. Can we have a moment of silence for that?
At that young point, though, I think both of us had that idea that
for sure.
That's just a fucking, it's just bullshit. It's like you can be smart and you can be wise. Yes. And those things are not mutually exclusive. Right. But I think for a lot of people, it's a way to write off one whole section of learning, one whole section of knowledge, one whole section of wisdom by just saying, and don't get me wrong, being someone who's learned is not easy. It takes practice. It's hard. It takes constant, you're constantly continuing trying to learn.
Right.
Right. You're constantly, you know, it's just like
you're constantly adding and refining that process.
Yes. Yeah. Just like when you work out, like if you stop working out, you're not going to be as strong. It's the same thing with, you know, learning and it's same. So it's not an easy process. And so people sometimes just hand wave it away as well. You know, anybody can do that research. I have the internet. Anybody can do that.
I think that there's a, one of the things this lady said that this speaks to what you're talking about that I think is interesting is she says, you know, she always wanted to be, if things had been different, she would have been a great first grade teacher.
Yeah.
And I think that there is a unfortunate series of life circumstances for a lot of people where they have a desire to be learned. They have a desire to like, to have some kind of connection to, college or university or, you know, education at some level, and they don't get that opportunity. They don't, for whatever reason, they don't have the resources, the time, etc. Right? But that desire to know things, it doesn't go away. That curiosity doesn't go away, but sometimes it can get channeled in some really fucked up ways.
Yeah.
And the idea, and all these people, and the fucking internet has made this word in my mind, like it's like a goddamn alarm bell when people say research.
Absolutely.
Research, just to your point, research about is like working out. Like you have to learn how to do it. You have to do it frequently. It's a skill. You have got to have this skill. You don't know how to research just because you Google shit and then click on the links that interested
you.
That is not researching. Yeah. It doesn't matter if you did that for 500 hours.
Yeah.
You didn't research. Research is a process.
Right.
You have to learn it. There are classes on how to research things for a very good reason.
Sure.
And
there's a whole employment class of people, librarians, who do this literally for a living.
That is exactly true.
And that is not a bachelor's degree.
No, to be a professional librarian.
That's an advanced degree.
Yeah.
So understand,
you're not scanning books at the front desk.
Exactly. Yeah. Understand that that's not just like a throwaway, like that's a lot of work to be a librarian.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. It takes years.
And like if you are a research scientist, you spend your life working in research.
Right.
Not spending your life Googling and clicking on shit that interests you.
Sure.
That is not the same thing. Unfortunately, we've lost that thread. We've democratized the idea of the word research and the idea of everybody can learn anything about anything. And it's not, I mean, I hate to say it, but in almost all cases, it's not true. Almost all things, if you are going to learn about them, require a significant amount of specialization of knowledge and expertise and training and mentorship. And, you know, and we don't give people good opportunities. Shame on us.
Right.
Socially, right? We don't give people good opportunities to go to college. We don't have a robust social safety net.
Sure.
We don't have the pieces. So you have these people who are curious and they're interested and they're a little insecure maybe about their intellect because they do have a desire to be something, but they didn't get a chance to be the something that they wanted to be, right? And I'm not saying that that's the only way to be something. I'm saying this is specific to this type of... So those folks are uniquely vulnerable.
Yeah.
Because if they latch on to conspiracy theory shit, then that's an opportunity for them to have discovered the big idea.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And it's wrong.
So in this particular story too, Tom, the woman who is the subject of the story talks about the research that she did. And she talks about how she called all these places to ask about the buckets of blood and the bone matter and all that stuff at Sandy Hook. How did you get it cleaned up? How did you do this? And she said she called a bunch of times and she did a bunch of research and she couldn't find any record of them doing it. And so the author of this article, who's the author of a book,
who's a journalist,
she literally called the place. They gave her the number. She called another company. Mm-hmm. And that company said, yes, we cleaned it up. We do biohazard stuff. And she's like, yeah, but they're like a harbor cleaner. They do spills. She's like, they do all kinds of things. You would have known if you'd have called them on the phone.
Right.
But you didn't. What you did was something else. That's not following a lead. What you did was just... basically reinforce what you already believed by stuff you found on the internet.
Yeah, man. I think of this as like the fucking Aaron Brockovich syndrome, right? It's that we sort of have this idea that the everyman is just as good as the trained man.
Yes.
And journalists are trained to do research, right? That is another type of person who goes to school to learn how to do research. So they know how to track down a lead. They know how to like push past and get the right answers and call the right people. And who do we get? And how do you file a FOIA request? Yes. There's a process. Yeah. And regular guys who have never been trained, we're fumble fucking our way through everything.
And then the shortcut is, I'll just do what I thought was right anyway. I'll just believe what I thought I was going to believe. I'll just reinforce what I was going to find anyway. And then
because everything I clicked on was the things I was already agreeing with,
man. And then you go to memory hole and fucking time cube or whatever fucking dumbass website, and it just reinforces exactly what you wanted to hear.
Do you remember, and they probably still make them, but I haven't seen them in forever. But do you remember, I think they were called Chifton or Clifton. They were manuals for your car.
Yeah.
You could buy, and you probably still can.
Yeah.
You could buy a book that outlined every piece of your car.
And it showed you how to take everything apart. Yeah.
And I think those are great tools. Like I would never open one because it would be literally useless to me.
I wouldn't know what to do with it either.
But I think of this as, it's like if you bought one of these Chifton books or Clifton books or whatever the fuck they're called, and you said, well, I have this book about a 1997 Ford Escort. So I am a mechanic.
Yeah. So I'm going to take this Bugatti apart. Right.
Exactly. So it's like, well, I I leafed through one of these Clifton books.
One time at the library opened one.
You know what? Yeah. I have replaced the alternator in my 97 Ford Escort. So I'm pretty much a certified auto mechanic.
Yeah, actually, you know, you can also attach HVAC onto that too. Because I once turned on the air conditioner.
Exactly. I changed the furnace filter once in a while. So I pretty much have this down. I know roughly
where it is,
how this works. It's in the basementular area.
So quickly, Tom, I want to talk a little bit about how awful this woman is.
Because she's terrible.
Because she's pretty terrible. I want to talk, I want to read a little piece of this. So she's, they sort of call her out for having a Pinterest board with like weird children like Angela from The Office.
She has like a weird shrine on her Pinterest board.
Yeah, she has like a weird thing where like the kids are... like have really blue eyes and they like look like it's crazy. So,
it's like a virtual precious moments shelf.
Exactly. So
it's fucking weird.
There's already some weirdness. But then she says, like, I guess she says that she starts talking about the people that lost kids in Sandy Hook saying, you know, they look too old to have kids at age. Where's their type of jewelry? Where's their torn clothes? They're too old to have these kids. But then they come on and they're like, a little too stoic. And she's like, why aren't they more upset?
Right.
And so like there's no good back and forth here. They have to be perfect. And if they're not perfect, then they're lying to her. And that's one of those things that the author sort of tries to call out. But there's a part of this that just is so repulsive. Evidently, one of the young ladies who died was a young lady named Grace. She was 7 years old. A child that liked to paint. And the mother told CNN, the Anderson Cooper, that Grace had drawn a peace sign and a message, Grace loves mommy, in the fogged bathroom mirror after a shower, leaving traces her mother found after her death. I think that's very sweet.
It is very sweet.
And it's very heartbreaking.
How much would that hurt?
And it hurts.
Oh my God.
It's amazing. But it's, yeah, but it's one of those moments that like it makes it so that like people who are maybe on the fence of the gun debate, like that might be the thing that catches them. Like, holy right. shit, what the fuck? Your kid yeah. left a fucking piece of, unbelievable.
Yeah. Yeah. That would reach into your, like if you are a parent or like you just have anyone in your life that you've ever loved.
Yeah.
That would reach into the part of you that's like, oh my God, like yeah. those little messages that we send each other.
Yeah.
And that like, and those could all just go away
yep.
like that yep. forever. Like that's the value of this kind of exactly. empathetic journalism.
And then, and the, so that's what they're doing. But then she comes out and she says, and evidently, after her her white casket was there, the two children, the other two children, Chris and Grace's brother, so evidently the I don't know exactly who, and Grace's brother Jack used markers to fill its stark emptiness with colorful drawings of things Grace loved. And then this is the line: Wyatt mocked this reminiscence in a sing-song tone. Oh, Grace. She loved, 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 loved Sandy Hook. And we're so glad she's in heaven with her teacher and her classmates. And we feel so good about that. She had a white coffin and we busted out the Sharpies and drew a skillet and a sailboat. Nobody cried, she barked. So that's,
wow.
So not seeing someone break down on film, an edited version, like they're not showing, it's not a fucking, it's yeah. not Princess Di, yeah. right?
Right?
So they're not showing yes. the entire fucking funeral. They're showing like a tiny little clip. And if somebody didn't break down in that clip, they're lying. And then you're going to mock them for, you know, trying to remember their child, the last moment that the child is, you know, the child's yep. body is still around. Like it's a horror. It's an absolute horror. And she's a terrible person.
And I think, the one of the major problems with these conspiracy thinking type events and type people and the is that when we don't humanize each other, we dehumanize each
yes,
other, right?
Yes.
So there and her decision that she is making, and it is a decision that she's making to believe that this is all an untrue false flag narrative that she's being sold this to, that is dehumanizing. It's pulling her out of an empathetic state of mind. And that is necessarily dehumanizing people who are engulfed in tragedy.
Yeah.
And if we are unable to like connect with people who are engulfed in tragedy, we are dehumanizing all of us. And there's no point in making change. There's no point in having society if we aren't humanizing. We should always be working yeah. to humanize each other.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's a, this whole article though, you know, there's this part where I think that she really shows this woman being an awful person. And, you know, there's a part of me that's like, that just wonders, do they just revel in the meanness of it? Because there's people out there in the world. We know there's people yes. out there in the world. The atheist community is filled Sargon. With some of these people, right?
Sargon yeah. is a great example. They Dude revel. Just loves being a dick.
They revel it's in his thing. Being mean.
Right.
They want to be mean to people. They want to hurt people. Yep. They want to see people break.
And that's wonder, their value add,
yeah,
right?
And I wonder if the conspiracy crowd has those people too, and she just happens to be happens, one of
yeah.
them.
Why not? Like it would not, I don't think, it would not be out of character from other descriptions of her interpersonal interactions,
yeah.
right? She talks about how like, oh, I should have been a first grade teacher. My whole life has been about a kid, about kids. I love kids. I have this shrine to kids. But then when they talk to her kids, they're like, you basically ignored us all the time.
Yeah.
You like weren't a loving, doting, like you didn't provide a yeah. stable home. You weren't like, you just ignored us all the time. It's a fucking show. So it would not be, I think, out of character for her to just be like, yeah, like whatever. I just fucking being cruel. All the rest of this stuff is the trappings that I need to put in front of my
yeah.
cruelty.
Yeah, right, right.
It's
right.
the salad dressing.
Right, exactly.
It's a fun, happy, easy, feel good business. A very easy job for any guy out there to do. Everyone has to drive, just feel good, feel comfortable, feel wonderful with those beautiful feet at the pedals, and let's make a difference. Let's show our love with our feet, and let's be proud, and let's bring love to our brothers with our feet.
I love this article, and the last line of this article is fucking perfection. It comes from the New York Times. Walking on hot coals, a company event goes wrong. More than 24 employees of a Swiss company were injured while walking in bare feet over hot coals, an ancient religious tradition that has become popular on corporate retreats. I have been on corporate retreats. Have you been on corporate retreats?
No. I work in higher ed, so we do retreats, but they're not. They are the antithesis of corporate retreats, Tom.
Brother, I am so glad that we play golf. Not because I happen to have any great love for golf, but because I am so glad we're not doing trust falls and fucking ropes courses with our fucking managers.
We're all going and
walking over coals.
We're all going to go to a group Tony Robbins thing together.
Yeah. One time I went to an event that had a like a motivational speaker, and he was so bad. He was so bad that he like that. Not only have we never gotten another motivational speaker, but he has become a like constant joke. He is a refrain that I will bring up occasionally in meetings. Wow. I'll be like, well, at least it's not the steaks in the refrigerator guy. And everyone will laugh because that means something, you know, to everybody else. Because this guy was so, I'm so fucking glad. If I'm ever at a thing.
Did he give it up afterwards? Was it so bad that he gave it up?
That he gave up speaking?
That he gave up speaking?
I know we as a company have, in our area at least, have never hired another motivational speaker after that guy.
Wow.
We were just like, that is a waste of time every time.
You know what the best motivational speaker for any business is them sitting you down and offering you to pay you more money.
Yes.
That's the best
super motivating
motivation that you could possibly imagine. I don't need a dude to come in and be like, you really got to love your job. Be like, you really got to pay me more.
Right.
Like that's literally it. That will make me motivated to do anything.
Sold.
Anything.
Sold. Every 2 weeks I'm motivated.
Like, hey, guess what we're going to do?
Right.
You know, I don't care about a fucking beanbag in the break room. No, I don't care about foosball or whatever.
Yes,
I don't care.
You. Like,
just pay me. Fuck you, pay me.
Oh, we got a cotton candy machine. Just give me the money for the cotton candy machine.
Yeah, exactly.
I literally split it
up between everybody, even if it's $3.
Yeah, I'd rather
split it up
don't
between
care.
Everybody.
And everybody feels the same way, right? Everybody. And here's the litmus test I always use for this. If you won the lottery, would you keep your job?
Yeah.
Almost nobody says yes. And it's like, that's because you do this for the money.
You do it literally because you get paid.
Because if I take the everybody money piece, if we stopped giving you checks every 2 weeks, you still coming in?
I know.
No?
I know there are some people out there that have a calling. They're the unicorn and they found
they have
that
a vocation
one thing
or whatever.
That's just like, this is their thing. But I'll tell you what, even working in a place that really does push sort of, you know, a higher ed mission, I would say that I would say 99% of the people there wouldn't come back if they won the lottery.
No. And the thing is, like, I actually like my job. I like my job. I've never said that before. I like my job. But 100%, like, if I win the lottery tomorrow,
never.
I would not have a job because it's like,
I wouldn't even let them call me.
Look.
I would hire a private investigator to make them like kidnap each one and make them forget me.
Right.
I would waterboard each one person and make them never. They'd be like, I would get like Jesse the Body Ventura to like waterboard everybody who knew me at work so that they would be like, do you know who he is? No, I have no idea who Cecil is.
They
forget me.
I would hold up a picture of myself and then feed people roofies and slap them until they forget who I am. Just forget me now. So here you go. Wow. No, we're done. That's it. Yeah, like absolutely. Like but these fucking like corporate retreats where they make you walk on coals to show you they're like more powerful than your fear and the state of mind is only a state of mind or whatever that kind of nonsense is. And I love that they go and every once in a while this happens. This is like something that happens where every once in a while they don't rake the coals right or they're a little too hot or they didn't use the right kind of wood or people walk too quickly or a coal stuck in between your biscuit toes and you fucking get burned super bad.
Really bad, yeah. You're like Michael Scott putting his foot on a Foreman grill. Like, seriously, these people are, and it's so funny because, you know, there's like that peer pressure. You're around everybody else.
Yeah,
even if you think it's fucking bunk, you can be like, man, I'm not going to do that. It's stupid. One, you can, if you're trained properly, do this. What they were talking in this article, the guy did it for like, a football field and a half or something. Because it just doesn't transfer heat properly if you know what you're doing.
If you walk the right way.
You got to walk without rhythm and it won't attract the work. No, but seriously, like you just got to figure it out.
Walk
like,
this way.
But if you figure it out, great. But they normally give these training sessions in a short amount of time. So this guy who did the world record running over coals, he's been doing it for decades.
Right.
The people who do it for a couple hours or learn about it for a couple hours and then do it, it's just so stupid. It's just so patently stupid.
And
as a motivational thing, it has no point. It's literally, I mean, there's so many better team building things that you can do. Yeah.
Man, have you ever felt, have you ever seen something that was like really scary and you weren't sure you wanted to do it and then peer pressure made you do it?
Sure. Yeah.
So I was thinking about like what you were saying. And it's like, I know that if there was a corporate retreat and all of the other like executive types were there and there was a walkover Kohl's thing, I would just raise my hand and tell you, I would walk over those Kohl's. Sure. I would 100% raise my hand to be the first guy that did it, right? Because I am every day in direct competition with my peers.
Yeah.
And that's I am aware of that. And so I need this job. I want this job. And I am in direct competition with my peers. I would be like, yeah, 100%. Let's fucking do it. Because there's something on the line. It's unfair for a company to create that kind of pressure.
Right.
Because it's not that they're facing their fears necessarily of walking over hot coals. A skill, by the way, which transfers as badly as the heat from the coals. Absolutely valueless thing to know how to do. Unless, like, what are you, like, going to, like, have, like, a backdraft moment in your life and you're barefoot and you're like, I'm so glad Tony Robbins was there.
I was able to save mittens.
You're right. What the fuck? Like, when do you need this?
You could have the same exact experience, though, if you're just like, hey, everybody, here's a journal. Go sit in a corner and write something really meaningful and then I'm going to pair you up and now you're going to talk about it or something.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like,
yes.
You could have a similar experience. I don't even know what I'm doing and I just thought of probably a more meaningful experience
right.
than circle jerking around a bunch of coals. It's not useful. And so like actually, and it is pseudoscience-y, right?
Yes.
Like that's the problem is that's why we're even talking about it because it's got that layer, that veneer of pseudoscience. One, that it's hard to do and that you like
it's just physics.
It's not hard. Once you learn how to do it, it's really easy to do. In fact, like I said, the guy fucking probably could have took a nap on it for crying out loud.
But then, it's like laying on a bed of nails.
Yeah. But then the fucking fact is that it doesn't do anything. It doesn't do the things you need it to do. And now in this particular one, these people, like there's dozens of people got hurt.
Yeah, man. And they got like second and third degree burns. And then the organizers take absolutely no responsibility, right. Of course, because liability. And I got to read this last line. The last line is fucking everything to me. The organizers of the event in Zurich, Tommy Widmer, said in an interview with the Swiss news outlet Blick that he had warned participants to not stroll, run, or hop across the fire, but to walk across it in steady, quick, military step-like clip. Mr. Widmer said he felt sorry for anyone who got hurt, but denied he had responsibility for the accident. Quote, it could have been a great event, he said. yeah. But it wasn't because 24 people burnt their feet.
What were you wearing on your feet?
It could have been
a
great event.
Clearly your fault. That's amazing.
Well, yeah, the Challenger could have been a great space ride. But it wasn't.
Might have been really fun for a few seconds.
Yeah, right?
Critics are calling it a less violent Passion of the Christ. I never knew how much Jesus used the N-word. Jesus uncrossed.
No more miss the nice Jesus.
This story comes from the New York Times. It's a bit of a massive, massive letdown. Unsurprising,
yeah.
Though, unsurprising. The Supreme Court strikes down a New York law limiting guns in public. So New York had a law that said, hey, if you want a handgun, you got to get a license. And if you want to do anything with your gun other than keep it in your house for self-defense, so you want to take it somewhere, you've got to have a valid reason to take it somewhere.
I talked about this a couple weeks ago. I don't know if you remember when I said, you know, it used to be that you used to have a valid reason. And it turns out that I just knew, I must have known that in a few states, that's still a thing.
Yeah.
And New York was one of them. It's one of eight.
Oh, it's one of eight.
One of eight
says,
states,
okay.
I think.
So that seems reasonable, right? So if you're a, I need a gun for self-defense despite all the statistics and evidence kind of guy, and you want to have a gun in your house for self-defense, you can still have one. That totally fine.
Yeah.
But if you want to go a travelin's with it, you got to have a reason. And valid reasons would be like hunting. That's a valid reason to take your gun out. Target practice is a valid reason to take your gun out. One of the guys that brought the suit even got the okay to take his gun to and from work. But what New York said was like, look, just speculating wildly that this might come in handy if is not a valid fucking reason to take your, to be armed on the street and just wandering about as a fucking aimless, untrained, unregulated, unlicensed, armed citizen, right? Yeah. And the Supreme Court was like, nah, 6-3.
Yeah. And it's again, down these party lines
yep.
where the far right has infiltrated that court. And now it's 100%, you know, every single thing that comes up that we knew was going to be a problem, you knew it.
They literally, the Supreme Court literally wasn't even taking up Second Amendment cases
yeah.
until they got the 6-3
until they got the people there.
Super majority
yeah, until they got the
in the
there.
Goddamn courts.
Yeah. And what they have now is they, and it's not even 5-4, right? It's not even yeah. that split where one guy might lean over. No, right, it's 6-3.
This is Duncan.
And this is one of those things too, where you're just like, look, man, it's just, they're just saying you need a reason for it. And they're like, well, but I shouldn't have to need a reason for a gun at all.
Second Amendment.
And I really wonder, you know, they're talking right now about maybe putting something in that's bipartisan in the Senate.
Yeah.
Right. That is a few, the tiniest fucking checks on guns, like the tiniest yes. checks. You need, like, it's, there's a, they can open juvenile records now where I guess they couldn't before.
Yeah. So they do a background check. Your juvenile records would be flagged.
If you're somebody who's like murdering puppies as a juvenile, that shit might show up now and that might stop you from getting a gun.
Who opposes that?
I don't understand it. I just
who opposes that?
But clearly it wasn't a thing. And then there's like one or two other things.
There's a strengthening of red flag laws. Yeah. And I think those are really important tools.
Yeah. But really when you think about it, it's not like a big sweeping reform.
No, this is not once in a generation type legislation.
Right? It's
yeah.
little stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
But there's enough people there that are getting enough calls from the people in their yep. district that even Republicans are on fucking board for this. They're yep. like, yeah, no, even the Republicans are on board. So they're like, okay, we're going to do something. I wonder if that's even going to make it past this.
You think the Supreme Court will strike it down?
They'll just be like, I wonder if the moment it gets past, somebody's going to take it immediately in. They'll be like, no. Because the Supreme Court runs the show now.
Yeah, man. I've wondered that about red flag laws. I wonder if the Supreme Court won't say, hey, you have, because the language they always use is that we can't take away the rights of law-abiding citizens and the right to have a gun and fucking carry it around next to your dick as much as you yeah. want is your Second Amendment right. And until you break the law, at which case, you know, like, because of course, you know, in America, once a felon, fuck you forever.
Oh yeah,
right?
Absolutely. Yeah.
So, you know, but and I don't know that I necessarily disagree with that with relation to guns.
Sure,
though.
Yeah.
But it's still, you know, but a law-abiding citizen should not have, a red flag law says like, well, we're worried and we have reason to be worried. And so we are going to take a gun away from a law-abiding citizen. We're doing a crazy thing where we're waiting for people to break the law before we say, well, don't break the law again.
Yeah.
And the problem with guns is if you break the law with a gun, someone probably died. Mm-hmm. So I would rather have somebody not be able to have their dirty, hairy fantasy bullshit lived out
yeah.
than to have like, oh, well, next time you can't murder someone. You can't murder someone twice. That's bullshit.
What's crazy too is like, these people, you know, some of this stuff won't stop, you know, some of these people who have already committed some of these heinous crimes,
right?
These laws that they're putting in place because they're getting these calls might not stop some of the stuff that wouldn't have stopped some of the stuff that happened before.
Right.
And in some ways, Ted Cruz is right when he's like, their laws won't stop this stuff. And it's like, and I turn back all the time to be like, then do something that will, man.
Yeah, man.
Get something going that'll stop this. Get something going that will stop it. Because we're the only country that does this. We're the only country yep. in the civilized world where, shit, we're probably the only country in the world where you could just send your kid to school and them and 20 of their classmates can die in the same day without even.
And nobody does anything.
Nobody does a damn
And nobody
thing.
Does anything.
Yeah, nobody does
fuck
CNN to Anderson Cooper comes by to catch your tears in his fucking camera lens for a few hours. Yep. But that's the only thing that happens.
That's it.
That's it.
Yeah, I read an article, like there were proposals to raise the age to own certain types of guns from 18 to 21. 21 yeah. Not even to own, to buy,
yeah.
right? So there's a distinction yeah. there because I can give
sure.
like a long gun. Crazily enough, you can give a long gun to a young person. Handguns are more restricted. Yeah. And that's not crazily, but I just think it's insane that you can give a gun to like sure. a 12-year-old, right? But you can in most states. So, but some of the opposition to this that I read from, of course, Republican lawmakers was something like, and I'm paraphrasing, but only by a little bit, 18-year-olds are the most in danger and the most 18, 19, and under 21 are the most likely to need a gun for self-defense. And it's like, well, okay, but even if I, and I don't know if that's true, but if I were to suppose that that were true, I would then have to ask the next question, which is, well, why is that so? And it's because 18, 19, 20, 21-year-old people are fucking reckless.
And they're the ones who probably get into the altercations that cause that stuff.
And if you've got a gun, you feel more fucking invincible.
Fucking A, man.
And now all of a sudden, it's like you're fucking flexing because you feel like you've got, you know, a little something-something because you're fucking strapped. Like, it's bullshit. They don't take it. They're so gung-ho about protecting this fucking fantasy that they don't bother to ask questions. And I think they know the answers to them.
Right.
It's posturing. Right. This is all posturing.
Right. Exactly.
Bring, bring. Hello? Oh, okay. Sorry, guys. I have to go meet someone.
That's not a phone. It's a banana.
It's for you.
Hello? Mr. President!
Oh, this is fucking great.
Is there
and there's
clip?
Video.
Is there a clip?
There is a clip.
Oh, Tom.
There is a clip. So this is from Salon. And again, I don't like Salon. I just grabbed him because there's a clip here that's worthwhile. I can see your screen. Ron Johnson busted after saying he's on the phone to avoid January 6th questions.
Here we go, Tom. Here we go.
It's so great.
How much did you know about what your chief of staff was doing with the alternate slates of electors? No, you're not. I can see your phone. I can see your screen.
What your chief of staff was doing?
Does your chief of staff still work for you, Senator?
Can you explain what happened there? Why
no
was
connection.
Your chief of staff even offering?
That's so awesome. He's like, so great.
He's just keeps, he's like, I guess I'm just going to have to do this. I guess that's how it works now. That's so amazing.
What a fucking coward.
God.
What a fucking coward.
You know,
these are reasonable questions. These are not gotcha questions.
The questions they're asking are essentially, he got given a bunch of fake, I guess, ballots or whatever, or something like that, like, or fake electors, a list of fake electors. And he like supposedly sight unseen gave it to someone else. I think it was Pence or something. He gave it to someone else. So it was given to him to give to someone.
I think his chief of staff was getting in touch with Pence's chief of staff. Yeah.
And he didn't ask any questions.
Right.
And so that's what this is coming down to, is that this guy, this senator, and Ron Johnson, we've talked about this fucker before.
Yeah.
This guy is like, he fucked up and now he wants to just avoid all the questions. He's got to fucking hide from it.
Yep.
All. And this is so perfect because like you and I have been talking for a couple years now about how nobody pushes anymore. And especially when it was Trump, when Trump was in office, we were just like, God, nobody's pushing. There's so many times you just be like, no, I'm going to push. And if you don't, then I just never come back and that's okay.
Yep.
Now they're starting to push.
Yeah, they are.
And I love it.
It's so
good. I love it.
I love that he called him out. Hey, man, I can see you're not on your phone.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like I can see your screen.
I can see your screen.
Who are you crapping, old man? Like we can see when you're on a goddamn phone call. Your phone lights up.
I don't know how this technology works.
These guys are such bullshit cowards. It's amazing.
He's such a boomer. He has no idea how it works.
He'll be fooled when I hold this.
Oh, so amazing.
Rectangle to my ear.
We just had a brick and he was just talking. You know, like he just had a brick. Or
picks up his shoe, like get smart.
Chicken leg up to his head or whatever. It doesn't matter. He grabs his secretary and holds her up to his face. He doesn't care what it is. As long as I can get out of this call.
You can get, you see, I'm on the secretary.
Sucking amazing.
Hi, I'm Derek Bum. Say goodbye to daily stains and dirty surfaces with new Kitchen Gun. This sink is filthy, but just 3 shots from Kitchen Gun and it sparkles like new. There, all clean again. New Kitchen Gun, now with laser sight and night vision for after dark cleaning.
Yeah, a lot of Texas talk in the last couple of weeks here.
A lot of Texas talk. So I grabbed this story because the Texas Republican Convention, and this story I think does a real nice job of laying out that the Texas Republican Convention comes together and they put out a platform.
Yeah.
And it's a bunch of stuff that they all agree is important to be a Texas Republican, not stuff necessarily they think is actually going to be able to happen.
That's not,
But it does give you a strong sense of their ideological position.
Gives you an insight into who they are.
Right.
Yeah.
So I want to read, there's some bullet points in here, and I want to read some bullet points. This is as dystopian a world as I can imagine living in.
Yeah. This is something that someone couldn't imagine.
Right.
Right.
I was genuinely floored. Sure. We've been doing politics now for 15 years.
This
is from their platform. requiring Texas students to learn about the humanity of the preborn child, including teaching that life begins at fertilization and requiring what? Students to listen to live ultrasounds of gestating fetuses.
In do they,
school!
Do they do like whale song?
It would be- Kids are falling asleep like a white noise machine.
Get the fuck out of here. Listen to the sounds of the gestating fetus. That sounds like a new age album.
Right? Or a really dark metal album.
It's got that parrot for a lyricist or whatever.
Amending the Texas Constitution to remove the legislature's power to regulate the wearing of arms with a view to prevent crime. So they would change the Constitution so they can't even pass laws that mean you can't have guns. We can't even, you don't even have the power to think about this. You can't even,
it's like that old sign that says, don't even think of parking here.
Yes.
It's basically, if you thought about it, we're going to kill, we will kill you. We will kill you.
Fuck
and
you.
We'll know.
We will kill you and we can do it because we're strapped at all times.
We will know if you thought about it. Just by the way you're looking at my gun, I think I'm allowed to kill you.
We will know if you thought about it because you'll be the only one thinking in Texas. Treating homosexuality as an abnormal lifestyle choice, language that was not included in the 2018 or 2020 party platform. So going back to this, we talked about last week. Deeming gender identity disorder a genuine and extremely rare mental health condition requiring official documents to adhere to biological gender and allowing civil penalties and monetary compensation to detransitioners who have received gender-affirming surgery, which the platform calls a form of medical malpractice.
Fucking yikes.
Just straight up.
Holy yikes.
Changing the U.S. Constitution to...
Let's just roll back for a second.
Yeah, yeah.
If you told me, if you read that and you said, pick 1 year, 1943 Germany,
right? Yeah,
or 2022 Texas. I might not get that right.
Yeah, man.
I might not get that right.
This shit is as egregious.
Yeah,
it's not just.
Yeah, the last two, treating homosexuality as an abnormal lifestyle choice. It's like
I thought that ship was sailing.
I literally want to otherize all the people here that are LGBT. I want to otherize all of them.
It's such a, like at this point, this ship sailed 20 years ago.
Yeah.
They're literally trying to, like, with these last two, they're fucking going back in time.
Yeah.
It's a fucking time machine.
This next one.
Changing the U.S. Constitution to cement the number of Supreme Court justices is 9, and then repeal the 16th Amendment of 1913, which created the federal income tax. What? Ensuring the freedom to travel by opposing Biden's clean energy plan and California-style anti-driver policies, including efforts to turn traffic lanes over for use by pedestrians, cyclists, and mass transit. They're basically like, look, more pollution.
We need more cars. I want my car to drive a car. I want to be like 5 cars down. I want a car under a car under a car under a car.
That would be mass transit.
And I want them all to roll coal. That's what I want.
Holy shit. Everybody's going to just drive a John Deere tractor. Just spilling oil out the back of
America's it. America's so fucked because we have such a shitty public transit system already.
I know.
And like, it's such an uphill battle for us to try to, because we spread out so far here in the States. We live in Chicagoland area. It takes me over an hour to get to Chicago from where I'm at.
Oh yeah.
You know, it takes me over an hour and driving it's way longer because it's, you know, the traffic. But if I take a train in, it's a little over an hour to get downtown, right? A little bit, just a touch over an hour. So that's like, but that's how far out we are from Chicago. Like we're a good distance out from Chicago and there's just, it's just literally, you know, miles and miles and miles of roadway and a few main arteries of public transportation. I have a train near me, luckily.
Right.
But there's a couple of suburbs and I know you used to live in Plainfield. There's nothing out there. Nothing. You have to drive 40 minutes to one
somewhere
place
else
to go to take a train if you wanted to do that. So like, we just made such a shitty system. Even around Chicago, we made a shitty system. Yeah.
And imagine in Texas.
Yeah.
Houston has shitty everything.
Yeah.
What could their mass transit be like? The air smells like shit. declaring all businesses and jobs as essential and a fundamental right, a response to COVID-19 mandates by Texas cities that required customers to wear masks and limited business hours, and abolishing the Federal Reserve, the nation's central bank, and guaranteeing the right to use alternatives to cash, including cryptocurrencies.
Good for them.
Which is just,
you know, look, here's the thing. You're definitely going to lose a lot of power if you go to cryptocurrency mining.
Holy shit.
I wouldn't trust that grid if I was a crypto miner. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me right now?
They put all those fucking crypto miners in there. Like it gets 70 degrees in Texas and everyone will just die. They will be out of power overnight.
I saw something this week, though, that said, and this was like a Business Insider article, where they said, like, another one of their things was they were planning on repealing the civil rights law that allowed, like, black people to vote.
Holy fucking shit.
I gotta
what?
See if I can find it now. Now
what?
I gotta find it. Yeah, man. Like,
so this story is from NPR. Not every plank of the platform came with a long explanation. For example, the section on the Voting Rights Act of 1965, which the Justice Department calls the most successful piece of civil rights legislation ever adopted by Congress, merely states that the Texas GOP supports equal suffrage for all United States citizens of voting age. The platform then calls for the 1965 law and its updated forms to be repealed and not reauthorized. The Voting Rights Act has returned as a key point of contention in the past decade as parties argue over election fairness, particularly in areas with histories of discriminating against or suppressing voters of color.
Right. So that means that I can just suppress you if I want, right? If I take those rights away, now I can just be like, yeah, you don't get a fucking voting station. You got to come over here.
Yep.
No, we get to make these decisions. You're not being discriminated against. Everybody, well, I don't see color.
Yeah, right.
You know what I mean? And,
look,
and that's the problem.
In the following neighborhoods, the voting hours are restricted to 6 a.m. To 7:45 a.m.
To 7.5 minutes at 2 p.m. or whatever.
Right.
Yeah.
And everybody, and otherwise you got to drive, you know, someplace. It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
You can make it so hard. You can just put up so many administrative and bureaucratic and functional, practical barriers to voting to essentially turn an entire demographic into a disenfranchised demographic.
And if you don't have those protections in place and you've abolished them, like that say you're not allowed to do this,
right,
then there's no protection. And then they're just fucked. Because again, because it's one of those things like, well, we fixed it. We fixed it. No, you didn't fix it. Look at fucking all across the country where, you know, you or I might have 2 or 3 minute wait times. There's 70 to 3 hour wait times in other parts of the city.
Yep. It's like, we fixed it. Okay, well then just keep it then. Like, what's the harm?
If it's not doing anything, what does it matter?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Exactly. Yeah. They want to fucking
the fuck out of here.
So I also want to, there was talk about secession too. And there's been a lot of talk about that too, which is, you know, like, look, man, the thing is like, I get, and I understand, Texas is on the verge of turning blue.
Yeah.
And I think they're really afraid.
They're freaking out,
they're
man.
Afraid.
Yep.
Because we saw last time that was a close election.
It was a nail biter.
That was
man.
A close election.
Yeah.
It could have went for Biden. It didn't, but it could have, right?
Yep.
It could have. You know, it wasn't like it was for years. Texas has been a red state for years with a lot of population, right? And that's the thing is there's plenty of red states, but they don't wield the same kind of electoral power that
Texas
a place like
Texas is the
Texas
ripest
does,
plum,
right?
Man.
And it absolutely is. It absolutely, and I think they're afraid. I think they're genuinely afraid that we're at this position right now where it could be in the next 10 years that they vote for president and it turns blue. It's possible.
Yeah.
Fucking California was red, man. Back in the day, California was red.
Yeah, I mean, and big parts of the South were blue.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's a constantly shifting map. It's a constantly shifting map. I agree with you. If you look at the county breakdown within Texas, your major metropolitan centers, of which Texas has several, they're blue as fuck. They're solidly blue.
Yeah.
So,
and that's where all the people live.
That's where the people live, man.
Yeah, man. It's just like, us. We have Chicagoland area to a certain point, and then it starts getting more Republican. You know, there's little bits from other places, but, you know, Champaign, Peoria.
Anywhere people live.
Anywhere people are. Anywhere there's a density,
you'll
get this group of people who will vote blue.
Yep.
And so, we're in a position now in our state where we're solidly blue.
Absolutely.
We're solidly
unquestioningly blue.
But other places in recent years around us have sort of flipped red-blue. You know, red-blue, depending on the candidate. So who knows what happens in the next 10 years? It could be that enough people leave Chicago for redder areas of the country because they're working from home, and suddenly Arkansas is blue.
Yeah, or North Carolina. Yeah. I think North Carolina might be the next one that flips over.
Yeah.
There's a lot of relocated transplants from metropolitan areas into North Carolina. It's booming.
Georgia, too, is one of those that right now is very much possibly. And, you know, here's the other thing, too. A blue Texas means all this bullshit that Texas is playing with the, you know, the abortion thing and all that stuff's gone.
Out the window.
Blue Texas means not just a blue Texas for the Electoral College. A blue Texas means a blue governor, a blue Senate, a blue, you know, down there. And suddenly that changes things.
I can see a Texas. I can see a vision of a Texas that's very much like a vision of Illinois, where it's a solidly blue state that occasionally has Republican governors.
That's all, you know? Occasionally we'll have a Republican governor too.
Yep, absolutely. Yeah. I can see that. Yeah. I can absolutely see that happen.
And that might happen. But I'll tell you what, you get it blue enough where they can't pull that shit, and it's possible. Yep. It's possible. You know what I mean? So I feel for all the people, like you said, huge metropolitan areas. I feel for all those people down there that have to deal with these chuckle fucks.
I do too.
That fucking run their state like they're fucking a bunch of idiots.
It's got to be so distressing to live. If you're just a regular guy in Austin or in Dallas or in San Antonio, those are solidly blue. You're likely blue. Like you likely are blue. It's a solid. You've got to look around and be like, the fucking pig farmers are in charge.
Yeah. The people who want to have the Trumpers are in charge. Yeah, MAGA hats are in charge. They're the ones they decide what's happening. And this platform is disgusting. Their platform is grotesque. Now they can't get it all done, but look at some of the stuff they've already done.
Yeah, I know.
And look at how horrible and dystopian that is.
It's one thing to look at this and be like, all right, well, that's your fucking evil Saddam Hussein-esque wish list, right? But we're living in a world now where the Supreme Court just said, hey, guess what? No more abortion.
Yeah.
You know, or I mean, they didn't say that. They said, what they said is leave it up to the states. Yeah. So, you know, it means that, like,
so Texas, no more abortion.
No abortion.
Yeah.
You know, we're living in a world where the Supreme Court said, oh, you know, we will take up those gun laws and we will strike them
and
all
down.
You
know what we're going to do is we're going to just let anybody have a gun. In fact, we're going to sign the bills with guns.
Everybody gets guns.
We're going to use ceremonial guns to sign the bills. I'm going to shoot like Annie Oakley, my fucking name.
We decide everything with 21 gun salutes. That's it. We actually go rock, paper, scissors, AR-15.
And
AR-15 wins every time.
I never throw anything but AR-15. Is this AR-15?
I don't know what that is.
I don't know. I'm probably throwing a gang sign.
Right. There's some affiliation now and we're going to get jumped outside.
That's fine. I don't mind. No, but like it is a horror. It's got to be a horror. And this extends to anybody who is, you know, a left-leaning person in a right-leaning area.
How
you know?
Nightmarish.
I mean, I lived in rural Illinois for a couple years, about 4 years. And I genuinely didn't put a Darwin fish on my fucking car because I was afraid it was going to get keyed.
Yeah.
I thought, you know what? They will key my car. Somebody will key my car. They'll see that and they'll be offended enough to key my car, even though I'm surrounded by Jesus fish.
Right. Yep.
And I never once in my life thought,
I'm going to key someone's Jesus fish. Right.
But I know for sure if I did that there, someone would react, or I'd get into a fight at the grocery store.
Right.
Something. And so I was just like, I just won't do it. I'm just going to
pretend. You got to live undercover.
Yeah. And so there's so many people who listen to the show who have to live undercover. They're atheists or they're leftists.
We get emails all the time.
And the only people that speak any sense are the people in their earbuds.
Yeah.
The rest of the people that they run into, they're like, fuck, I can't have a conversation with anybody. Cause they're just like, her dirt Trump, Bud Light. Oh. And then they fucking drink and then they die in 10 years.
Yeah.
Go home. This is motion to wars, isn't it, boy? Dative! Oh, Dative! Not the Dative! No! Against him! Against him! Domonta! Ad domon!
Except the Thomas takes thee!
The locative!
It is!
Domum!
Domum! Wom. Understand?
Yes, sir!
Now, write out 100 times.
Yes, sir! Thank you, sir! Hail Caesar, sir!
Hail Caesar! If it's not done by sunrise, I'll cut your balls off.
Oh, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Hail Caesar and everything, sir.
Oh. All right, Cecil. So I put this story in kind of as a placeholder. So from the New York Times, Uvalde school district puts police chief on leave after mass shooting. So I grabbed this story because if you're following the Uvalde massacre at all, one of the things that you cannot escape is the ever-shifting narrative from the police.
Yeah.
The original story was, oh, well, you know, the gunman showed up and he started shooting right away at the police. Well, no, that didn't happen. And then, you know, oh, well, we got in because some teacher propped the door open. Well, that wasn't true. And then, oh, you know, we were outside and we didn't have a key and we couldn't get in the door. Well, that's not true. It turns out either. No, the door locks were fucking broken. There was actually a requisition from the teacher to have the locks fixed on that door. They keep lying. And the thing that I am struck by, Cecil, is these cops are willing to lie when they know that the eyes of the world cannot possibly be trained more heavily upon them.
Yeah.
That should be the time where you're like, all right, definitely going to not pull any shenanigans.
They're lying with like hard eye contact and then doing the wrong thing while they're lying about it. It's like,
They are amazing. Balls deep in your wife's sister or something. And like, what, honey? What? As you're fucking thrusting.
I'm not doing anything.
What?
Yeah, it's amazing. But I got to say this. The one thing that I've seen, at least from the sort of, you know, the things that get picked up from the average Joe who's been disillusioned by this is heartening. Because they're starting to understand that the police aren't there to protect you.
Yes.
The police aren't there to save you.
They're not.
The police are there to protect capital. That is what they're there for. They're there to protect capital. They're there to gain revenue for their department.
Yeah.
It's not just for the state.
Right.
It's for their department.
It's for their department.
It's for their department so that they can have a job and continue having a job. And then they create these incentive programs in the government with these war on drugs incentive programs where then they create these drug busts that are nothing so that they can get more money.
More money, more funding, more seizure stuff.
You know, and then, you know, basically cement their place in the community by saying, you need us. Look at all this stuff we have.
Yeah.
You need us. But in any case, it's suddenly starting to spark in some people out there who might have been, you know, on that blue lives sort of thing.
Yeah.
And they're seeing like, holy shit, like the police, sometimes when you call them, they don't do what you ask them to do. And you just say, just be a person of color for 10 minutes and you'll know that that's the case.
100%,
right? You'll know that's the case. But
people of color have been telling us all this for years, decades, generations.
And people haven't listened. And now they're starting to see that, you know, that there's some serious problems. And one of the things that I noticed too about this is that they are very reticent to let out those body cams.
Yeah, they're not doing
it. Camera footage.
Yep.
They're very reticent. I don't know if they'll get it. There might be some sort of thing back and forth. If that stuff comes altered or edited or removed, someone should go to jail. But if they get it, I would imagine, I'm guessing, there's got to be something on there that they're trying to keep. And I wonder if they might have killed a kid.
Oh, shit. Yeah, you know
what I mean? It might, you're in a situation where you don't know what's happening. Somebody runs in. It might have been that something like, or you just get a chance to hear them talking and saying really shitty stuff.
I'm wondering if their cowardice will not be on display in a way that they cannot hide from.
Yeah.
You know, like the police protect all of those things that you were saying. Those are their primary functions. Yeah. And then the other thing that they protect is their own power.
Yeah.
They protect their lives, their power, their position. They protect that more jealously than they protect anything else.
Absolutely true.
It's why contempt of cop is a thing, right? Yeah. Because when you are contemptuous of a cop, their power, their hierarchical power is being threatened in that moment. And that is an inexcusable crime for law enforcement.
Yeah.
And that's why that fucking veteran got his hand broken with a baton for standing and asking a question politely.
Yeah.
Because anything that challenges that hegemony.
Got shoved down.
Yes.
And it bled from his ears.
Yeah. Yeah. So like they're lying to us in a time when just patently we should imagine this is the one time that they would not be able to lie. And anybody with half a fucking brain would know, all right, the eyes of the world are going to be on us.
Yeah.
We got to be clean. Everything's got to be up and up, above board. But if they're willing to lie when there's this much scrutiny, imagine how much lying takes place when it's somebody that has no resources, no cameras, no media, nothing. They're lying all the time.
They're
lying every day.
They were willing to murder Laquan McDonald, shoot him in the back as many times as possible. And every single police officer on the scene wrote a report that said essentially that he was coming at him and he deserved to get shot. And then you watch that tape and you're like, he's walking away. And he gets shot in the back.
They all got together and collaborated their story to write the report.
And the only reason it came out is because somebody found that body camera footage.
Yep.
And that lie would have been that there wouldn't have even been any issues whatsoever. Think about, George Floyd. Without that tape, what would that have been?
It would have been a guy who died resisting arrest.
It would have been a guy died resisting arrest. Yep. And I don't care if you had a couple of people there that saw it.
No, that makes no difference.
Enough. That's not enough. It's that tape. It's the tape of it. So we're seeing now, and look, I don't know what's on those tapes. And I'm not going to pretend to know what's on those tapes. I don't know what's on the tapes. But I will say this. We deserve, the people who want to see those things deserve to see them.
100%.
Our tax dollars paid for all that stuff.
Yep.
And it paid for it for a reason. It paid for accountability. And so if you are not willing to be accountable, you should be removed. And they removed this guy.
Yep. Good.
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 You're not willing to be accountable? Go. Go do something else.
This is...
Go be a security consultant.
Right. Go do something where you do not hold anyone's life in your hands.
Yeah.
Because they failed at every fucking level. They failed for almost 2 hours. They failed for an hour and 17 minutes to protect people that they could have and should have protected.
Absolutely.
And they owe us answers
to
this.
Yes.
But all the time, every day, this is happening somewhere.
Yeah.
Every day. Yeah. Every day somebody gets pulled over on the side of the road and they get the shit kicked out of them. And then the cop lets them go and they're afraid to call and complain.
Yeah.
Every day somebody gets thrown in jail for nothing. Every day people get beaten, they get killed. This is happening every single day of the year.
Yeah. So we are recording this maybe 15 minutes before we go live for a couple hours, I think, because we have at this point 2 full hours of tape on the January 6th hearings. We have the ones from Tuesday and the ones from today. Today's Thursday when recording this. Will release Monday, but recording this Thursday. And so we'll have 2 full hours worth of tape. I edited one down and then we have this other one. So we want to thank everybody for joining us on YouTube. And if you want, go back and watch that live stream. Go back and check that live stream out. We're going to watch the tape and then we're going to talk about it. I'm sure it's going to be pretty good. The last couple have been really fun. We've had a lot of fun with the people who have been in chat. So come join us if you have time. We're starting a little early, but 9 o'clock, normally 9-ish. Check socials, 9-ish. We're normally on Thursday night central and you can come join us and join the community. We know YouTube's getting a little more views now, but if you're around on Thursday nights, it's a lot of fun and people seem to enjoy it. So come check it out. And I also, by the way, last week on the live stream, we covered Judge Luttig's testimony and I wound up editing that. There's a video in our feed down below. I don't know where it is. You can find it. Just click on uploads and then there'll be videos. You can see that I basically took all the pauses out. I think that's what it's titled. I took all the pauses out of Judge Luttig's testimony. If you had trouble following Judge Luttig's testimony from the hearing, I think it's the third hearing they did last week, and you were having a hard time because he talked really slowly. And so slow. I cut all the pauses out. It's a little easier to understand. Go check it out. And if you're there, write a little comment. Super helpful. Write a comment under this video. Up thumb this video. It's all good stuff. Share it with your friends. All right, we got to go. We're going to leave you like we always do with the Skeptics Creed.